It's so good. All right. If this is your first time on the show, everyone, my name's Chris, and it's a pleasure to meet you. This is an interview-style show that we do every Wednesday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We bring on talent, interesting people, conversations, and stories that you may not have had on your radar, so in the hopes of growing the community and having a better community. Thank you so much to everyone who's dropping those gifts. Oh my gosh, by the way. To Lexi, obviously number one, and then Clary, and then at Cass as well. Thank you so much, everyone, for getting that 13 million. That was huge. That was huge. And Daddy Jay's here. He's whatever. Okay. Yuri, what's up, brother? Thank you. But on that note, our second guest is, I believe, still at work. And he informed me that, yo, check that out. That was a lucky spin. Good one, good one. Thank you. The tacos do mean a lot. I ate them. I feel very nourished. I feel very nourished now. So we're still waiting on AP, okay? But next up, we'll go ahead and have our third guest slide to second. So that way we can have AP still on. We just want to give him the proper amount of time to get here, right? Okay, so our second guest tonight, as I mentioned, he's had it on his mind to do this for a hot second. He's a stand-up gentleman who, to be honest, I'm still learning about, and I look forward to learning more about him with you all. Thank you so much for those wheels, by the way, my friend. If you guys didn't know, you do know. I don't know what you know about, though. Okay, anyway, our second guest tonight, ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, legend and longtime member of the app, the one and only Ben.
What's up, Chris?
Hello, Ben. How you doing, sir?
Jessica. So even though you won't do it, Chris, I'm starting off with a shot.
Ah, yeah. You know, alcohol and streams, it's not. It doesn't mix well, we found out. And that was fine. So cheers there.
Ben. What's up, buddy?
Just out of curiosity, was that some Jack Daniels fire?
No, this is Jim Beam Peach.
Okay, some Jim Beam Peach. Got it.
Okay.
Thank you. Ben, you've been on this app for a minute, yeah?
Been on here going on 2 years.
2 years, excellent. And what was the original reason that you downloaded the app?
Back when I first downloaded the app, I was involved in a car accident. So I was off work for 5 months. I was sitting home not doing shit.
This is a serious car accident. This isn't like a normal fender bender.
Guy rear-ended me. I was sitting still. He rear-ended me doing about 65.
Wow.
And then left.
Did they catch him?
Nope.
You're telling me someone got away with an accident? How did they even drive away from an accident like that?
He screwed up his truck pretty bad, but he managed to drive it away.
Wow. Okay. Well, if you feel comfortable talking about it, what were your injuries from that?
I had severe whiplash, concussion, which is that was the worst part. My concussion.
Really?
They're amazed I was able to get out of the truck and walk in a straight line because of how bad my concussion was.
Wow.
And I had a couple bruised ribs because I wasn't wearing a seatbelt. So I had a couple bruised ribs from the steering wheel.
Wow. Why did that result in – I guess how did that result in it not being almost fatal? Was an airbag deployed or –
No, he rear-ended me, so no airbags went off, which I'm glad it didn't, because it would have totaled my truck.
You were worried about your airbags. Truck at that point? Well, okay.
There's a reason for that. That truck holds a very special place in my heart. My grandmother bought that for me when I turned 16. We lost her 2 years ago.
I'm very sorry.
It was about 6 months after we lost her that I was in this accident. So all I was worried about was making sure that truck was able to drive. I still have that truck to this day. I put about $10,000 in it out of my pocket to fix it back up.
Just so that I could be like rehabilitated.
No.
Yeah. Okay. Let's dive into it. I think this is a good launch pad to dive into it. So family man, sentimental. And I mean that in a non-negative way, right?
I know what you mean.
I'm myself a very sentimental person. What was life like where you're from? You grew. You're close with your grandma, so any special attachment or time that you had spent with her or
she
any other members?
She raised me. She babysat me since I was 9 months old. Okay. I was in here every day. Even when I started going to school, instead of going to the public school, she paid to put me in a private school so that I would get on the bus from her house. I'd come in every morning. Even when I started driving, I'd get up 6 o'clock, drive into her house, have breakfast, and then go to school from here. Even though it's complete opposite direction of where I was going.
I'd come in here
just to see her. I actually moved in when we lost her. I moved in with my grandfather in here.
Wow. You got a big heart, dude. And that's commendable, man. So, I mean, congratulations to you for being the person that you are. And I'm sure that you would attribute a lot of that to who your grandmother was as a person and how she raised you.
100%.
Yeah. What else went on, I guess, early life before Meet Me? What were you interested in? Did you have any hobbies, high school? What was all that like for you?
In high school, I played soccer, and then I blew my knee out freshman year. So I was done.
Wow.
I couldn't play anymore. Now, I've always been big. Anybody that comes to my live, they know most of the hoodies I wear, they're monster truck hoodies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Bigfoot, Bad News Travels Fast. I know them all. Not so much the Monster Jam guys, but all the independents, I know them. That I'll disappear for days at a time, and people know I'm at a show. I'm either at a show or I'm up at the cabin hunting.
When you say a show, what kind of show do you mean?
Monster truck show.
Monster truck show?
Yeah.
How does that work? I didn't know that monster trucks did anything besides crush things. Is that actually competitive?
Yes. They'll do racing, freestyle, wheelies, and donuts, depending on the event.
Okay.
10,000-pound truck spinning in a circle.
It's really loud, right?
Yeah.
Loud. How much horsepower does a monster truck have?
My buddy that owns one out of Virginia, if we have our big motor in, we're pushing about 1,900 horsepower.
1,900?
To the wheels. 1,900 horsepower to the wheels.
To the wheels. Okay. That's like
a lot of horsepower.
It sounds like
yes, Aaron. Usually an arena is very loud. I do a lot more outdoor stuff.
You say you do. Does that mean – have you ever driven a monster truck?
When I was younger, I actually got on with the world's youngest monster truck team out of Florida. So I was driving a half scale.
What does that mean? What is a half scale? Educate us.
Instead of being a full-sized with 66-inch tires, we run smaller chassis, usually a Honda Civic engine, heavily modified.
A Honda Civic.
Wow. Civics were the best engine we could find.
Yeah.
To put in them. No, my favorite famous monster truck is Bigfoot. I know them all. Bob Chandler, the inventor of monster trucks, him and I have had dinner multiple times.
Wow. How did you get so into monster trucks? I've never met an enthusiast of monster trucks.
We've been going – there's a show about 2 hours from us in Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania. I've been going there every year since before I was born. And we just got really close with the company, the drivers.
Your mom was going?
Yep.
To the,
wow. There's been 60 plus shows we've done in the last 2 years. But in Bloomsburg, there's only been 40 events. My dad's missed two. The very first year, and then 1 year they had a flood. And we missed Bloomsburg because we actually went out to Ohio for a show.
Wow. Again, I just got to take another stab at it. What is the appeal? What drives you to be so loyal to this sport?
We do a lot of stuff for the kids, especially my friend in Virginia, Brandon Dare with Bad News Travels Fast. His biggest thing is it's all for the kids. You can stay up all night. And people that have me on Snapchat, they see we break something. We're there till 1, 2, 3 in the morning fixing it. And it's all worth it when that little kid comes up to you during pit party with a big old smile on his face. And just, you can tell he's in love with it. We're building a passion for the younger generation.
That's That's awesome, man. Where does this all stem from for you? You have a very strong bond with your family. It seems that you're very giving to others and kids, and want them to have a positive childhood. Where does this all come from for you?
It all goes back to when I was little, the driver's taking the time to tell me about the truck, putting me up in the truck, letting me help. It becomes something I love and I want to do for the younger generation. If we don't get the younger generation interested in it, we'll be done. Just like anything, you got to cure the younger generation to get them interested, to keep it going, to expand it.
You mentioned hunting too. So monster trucks is number one, it sounds like, but you also like to hunt. What type of hunting do you do?
I do whitetail deer, bear. I hunt archery a little bit. Not as much into that. I mostly do rifle.
And that's been a whole life thing that you've done.
I grew up with it, learned it from my grandfather and my dad.
I used to fish, but
Yeah, I do a lot of fishing. I've actually been looking into buying a kayak or a boat to be able to do more bass fishing. Most of what we have around here is trout.
interesting.
Notice I don't do muzzle loader.
I've gone fishing. Like I said, I used to do fishing, but after hooking the fish in like particular ways that it's difficult to get the hook out, I always felt
Yeah.
really bad. I felt really bad, and I just couldn't do it anymore. And I feel like, whoop, that's lights out. And I feel like if I were to go to shoot a deer or something, I'd just start crying. Like, I cannot do this, and I just feel this overwhelming guilt.
That's how my brother is. He hunted for 10 years. He only ever killed one deer. They'd see 50, 60 deer. He just couldn't pull the trigger.
I feel like he's the guy where you guys see the deer and he's like, hey, and he's shouting so that the deer has a
Pretty
chance to get
much.
away.
He didn't have the balls to do it.
All right, so back to you. you get on Meet Me, and it's 5 months of you having to recover. What was your experience like? How did the community become part of your recovery time?
It gave me something to do during the day. I got close with a lot of people, and at first I didn't go live. It took me, I'd say 10 months till I first went live. I got really close with Turk, and he kept telling me, go live, go live. I'd get in his box and everything, and he finally convinced me to do it one day, and here I am.
What was the hesitation? Why didn't you want to go live?
I knew nobody was gonna come in, and
You knew
it just
wrong. Were you afraid that people wouldn't come in? Were you nervous?
I figured I was gonna waste my time.
I could
I
sit
figured
there
I'd
and
rather stay in comments instead of having to go live. But they convinced me, and then I started going live. It was every night, and I'd get live for hours, and then a lot of stuff went down. Where I began to hate the app. I saw how it was changing from what it once was. It
All right,
became
let's
all
get
about
into
the
it.
diamonds. When I first got on here, it was about the connections, built making friends, building. Now, and there for a while, it still is, and you could disagree, it's all about the diamonds. Everybody's out for themselves. Everybody's pushing contest, contest, contest. Fuck a contest. I will never compete in a contest. If I get put in a contest, I will ban my account so I can't go live during a contest.
Well, what about that though has makes you feel disengaged, or why do you not like that there are contests?
Because the people that come to my live, they go to a lot of other lives. Most of the people I've met through Turk, Haley, Bev when he was on here, Cody, KMB, which by the way, KMBCDB.com gets you some merch. Hoodies are very comfortable.
It's nice.
And views during contests, views are down a lot unless you have a top badge. Everybody's in top badges, seeing what they're doing, how they're doing, watching the gifts in their live. I've never cared about gifts. I tell people, if people want to drop on me, I tell them to go drop on somebody else especially during contests, if they want to place in the contest, go drop on Turt, Haley, go drop on KMB, Jess, anybody else. I don't care about the diamonds. Just come in and talk.
Yeah. Do you feel that, though, the people who would care about that would naturally gravitate towards other people who would care about that?
100%.
And the people
if
who...
If you as a viewer care about who's placing where in the contest and hitting goals, you're going to naturally go to the lives that are placing in contests.
Mm-hmm.
That's why certain people have more views during contest time if they're doing well.
Do you feel, though, that then you can also exist in your own bubble, like your own section, where you're still communicating and talking with people that are like-minded and share the same interests as you?
Yeah. But the viewership, those view numbers are down, you know, 7, 8, 9, 10, very low numbers. You get discouraged. There's no point in going live if everybody comes in but they don't talk. Cody, Big Boss Man, he's one that comes in, he talks. Love that motherfucker to death. That's my big bro.
Sure.
He's one that makes sure he comes in and talks or he battles me. We battle constantly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so do you still feel this way or do you feel like your perspective is different about how the app exists? What is your position and why was it important for you to want to be able to talk with everyone?
I still disagree with a lot of stuff on this app and it is not what I came on here originally with, but I've started to come back because a lot of people started reaching out when I disappeared. I've barely gone live in the past month and a half. And I had people reaching out to me that had me on Snapchat, messaging me on here, wanting to know where I was, wanting to know what was wrong, why I stopped going live. So that showed me that even though I don't give a shit about the diamonds or the contests, that people do still care.
Mm-hmm.
So I decided to come back, and I've started going live more. I've been live more in the last 30 days than I have the past month and a half.
Mm-hmm. It seems almost as if not getting gifted is a point of pride for you. Like, to not get gifted is to be almost more, like, how successful you can be without being gifted, is that?
I'd rather get the views, people come in and talk, than people come in and drop diamonds. I don't care about the diamonds. I convert everything and drop back. I have cashed out, but it's very rare for me to cash out. I always convert and drop back. I try and hit everybody that gifted me. I try and gift them back.
Okay. Well, yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, everyone has their own perspective. And I think when you're talking about a platform that has hundreds of thousands, millions of people, you're going to have your own bubbles and different groups and people are going to gravitate naturally towards different
groups.
So on that note, what ways would you say that you feel like this app has been a positive platform for you? How do you feel that it has been something that has done something good for you?
It's been good because I've been in a bad place in my mind thinking about a lot of shit. And this app has given me an escape for that.
Mm-hmm.
People can tell when they come in my live if I'm in a good mood, bad mood, if I'm thinking too much. I get lost in my head a lot. When I'm in my head in a dark place, I go to KMB's live. Whether it's under my main account or one of my lurk accounts, KMB knows I come in there because his message is something I need to hear at the time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do you feel like it's almost like a sense of a relief or like an escape for you to have
100%. A relationship?
Yeah. Have you had the opportunity to meet anyone from the platform or connect and see them in person?
I've met two people off this app so far, one of which I regret meeting because they used me 100%. They shouldn't even be on this app. The other person I met, they're a good guy. He ended up deleting the app because of some drama. But he's actually local to me, and I still talk to him to this day. He at the time was my top gifter. Even though I hate gifts, he
we know that part. We got that part. Burn it all. but if you could, remove all of it, it sounds like your focus is that you'd like to be in a community and keep developing friendships and have friends.
I'd rather reach the people and talk to them and not worry about the gifts.
Sure. And I think that there's ways to do both. It's just depends on perspective, style, and approach. And then, and you know, what works or I find to be successful, or what you or Turk or KMB or Tad and anyone. I think that there's space for everyone to exist and be successful. And success is an objectable term, right? Like you can define it differently on here. For someone, it may be that they had one person listen to them. For another person, it could be that they made $1 billion in a day. And that's yeah. that's all good and fine, because at the end of it, as long as when you close your stream, you feel like you have your integrity intact and that you have done something that is reflecting positively of yourself, that's what really matters. And even if you leave feeling better about yourself, that's what matters, whether it's from being a streamer or being a viewer. And that's what's important. And I think that you're still getting that, whether or not it's coming from a gifting perspective or a streaming perspective.
100%. Perfect. I used to drop a lot on this app, and I regret most of what I dropped, not because I dropped it, but because of who I dropped it on. They didn't deserve it. I should have found somebody starting out and given them that leg up instead of the person that I did.
Mm. Well, and that's something that we can't always know. Again, you know,
live and learn. That's what I live by is the live and learn perspective. And there's a few people in these comments that know exactly who I'm referring to when I say I regret dropping what I did.
Yeah. I mean, these types of things happen. Friendships change. I think we could all think about who we were friends with in high school, or even our first day at our job, and where we're at with them now. And it's completely different. We don't.
100%.
Yeah, that personally.
We live and learn.
But sometimes I think we can also find people who we initially wrote off. I think one of them I can speak to is someone like Turk. I had nothing to do with Turk. I thought he was a bully. I thought he was someone who was super macho, Philly tough guy. And
Turk ain't shit.
And then one day we got into a battle, and I clenched up, and I was like, here we go.
I remember that. I remember him matching you in a random roast battle.
That's exactly what I was
scared right away.
It was a random roast battle, and I was terrified. I was like, wow, this is not someone I ever wanted to have to come across in this setting. And in fact, became the start of our friendship. And he's, to this day, I called him January 27th, the voice of reason. I think he can 100%. Be a voice of reason, positive
impact. He's been around a long time. He has seen a lot of shit. And him and I haven't always seen eye to eye on certain things. That's my brother at the end of the day. I'll do anything for that fucker.
Well, the point of the story, though, was just to bring home the fact of that whether you regret or don't regret is that the preconceived idea of someone or the way we see someone can be completely different from what our expectations are versus when you get to know them. So that's why I bring it up. So anyway, Ben, is there anything else that you'd like to talk about before we wrap up today that you're passionate about, interested in, anything at all?
Not much. I just got one question, Chris. How did you get started on the app? Nobody's ever asked you that question that I know of.
I've been saving it because the 1 year is coming up for this, but it dealt with me wanting to prove something. I had, it's a bit of a spoiler alert. Like, short story is it was heartbreak, like a lot of people. And then it turned into something more, but teaser, if you want to know the full answer to that, I think I gave some of it to Jay. But I'll give it a full in-depth on the 1 year for the show.
I'll make sure I tune in for that. And Jay, if you'd like to do an interview, I'm always available. I don't do a whole lot other than work.
That's cool, man. Well, thank you so much for coming on, Ben. You know, welcomed many different perspectives on here. I think that whether we agree or disagree on some things, that there's space and room for all of us to have a really good time. I'm happy that you're choosing to still invest and make friendships on the app.
Thank you, Chris. I appreciate you finally letting me on the show after, what, 4 months of trying?
Yeah, you tried for four months.
Yeah, I love you too.
You tried for 4 months.
It was quite a while. I was trying to get Chris to let me on the show, and he wanted to make sure I was in a good place with the app before he let me on here so I didn't get banned.
We tried.
I'll send you a hijack.
All right. Thank you so much. It was great. It was great to have you on, man.
All right, Chris. I appreciate it, man.
No, bye. All right. Is AP here right now? Guys, that was Ben. He's not wrong. For 4 months, I pushed him away. I was like, yeah, we need you to be a little more positive. I was like, I need you to be a little bit more positive before you come on. I think AP should be around here. He was at work. If any of you have a way to contact him, please let me know. I will eventually stop smiling. Otherwise, yeah, someone hit his pager. Otherwise, you know, let me talk for a second. This is a show we do every Wednesday at 9. It's an interview style talk show. It's where we bring on top streamers, up and comers, individuals who are making a difference and changes and waves on the app. Whether they've been here a short time, a long time, that's not the important thing to me. What's important is what is the content and message that they're looking to deliver. So if you know somebody that you would like to see featured on the show, or someone that you like, thank you so much, Lawyer, for the wheel. I appreciate that, man. Please let me know. Otherwise, you might have to throw someone in here who's already been on the show. Because I would hate to have someone let me be on the show. Jewel, Flex. Flex is him. Flex needs to do it. The thing is, I always feel badly having someone box up to do the show when I haven't promoted it. When I haven't said, hey, this person's going to be on, etc., etc. I'll tell you what. We'll give AP another minute. Like, Haley did it. Yes, we're looking for Flex. Flex, been looking for it. You know what? If Bossman would like to do it, that'd be fine. Because I promised him a while ago. I said to him that I'd like for him to do it. So if Bossman, if you'd like to do it, it looks like we've got an open slot, unfortunately, tonight. And we'll have to catch AP another time. But it's up to him. It's up to him. Otherwise, we can talk to someone else, or I can figure out a game for us to do tonight. Well, we have AP scheduled. It's just I think he still might be. He said he would be at work for a minute, and so we put him. I moved him from second to third. But these things happen. He could be. Maybe there was a raccoon in the road that he had to pick up and save. You know, there could have been like a raccoon in the road, and he's like, "Oh, come on, little guy." And then they move him, or maybe his local Aldi had like a 2-for-1 sale on croissants. You can't pass that up. And that's a thing too. Jim's gone. Jim left a long time ago. Jim, I know for sure, came in for that window where Ben was straight talking mad trash and then was gone. I'm be like, well, sorry, Jim. sorry, Jim. I promise you the rest of it was good. he was talking about kids and monster trucks. How was I supposed to know? It's totally different. And the guy before him sang country music. It was really good. I'm not in trouble. You're in trouble. Oh, ah. Christopher, watch. Okay. Wrong. Yeah, it was, playlist. Just out of curiosity, while we're waiting, if you're going to playlist, can you please do a hello, do something like that in the comments? If you're going to playlist, do a one, a hello, or something. Yeah, a playlist, a five. Don't worry. Oh, you won't. Yeah. See, look at all these playlist peoples. It's gonna be so good. I'm so looking forward to playlist. You know, I used to get so beat up when someone wasn't able to make it. But then I realized it's nice to be able to have like a decompression period. So the 1 year anniversary will be after playlist. It's the week after playlist. You guys may remember I had this little promo that ran on Instagram of me standing, and it had some cool editing and stuff. And that was like the height of the video content that I ever put out. But I'll tell you what, let's do this. I'm scared to do that, never mind. All right. Anissa, it's nice to meet you. And Erica, thank you so much for the favor. All right, We're going to do speed interviews, you guys. If you'd like to do a speed interview, potentially be featured later.
Speed interviews?
We're doing
What interviews? Speed interviews? Look at me. I'm dressed up because I didn't even know what was going on, but I look like your twin.
I didn't know either. Like, we showed up to work wearing the same thing, and now we're just good to go.
Well, you know, Deadpool wanted to battle me later, and I was like, Deadpool, there's only one way that you're battling me, and that's if I go and save kids from burning buildings.
Yeah, I like it. Okay. You know what? You're suited up for the occasion. You're good with not having promo?
Sure, let's go.
Hop in the box. All right, we'll do a speed one. Sorry, guys. If AP comes along, we'll figure something out. But until then, we're going to go ahead and have Flex jump in. Fairy, that looks great. That suit emoji looks great in name. All right, ladies and gentlemen, going in blind here. Unrehearsed, always unrehearsed. But one only, Mr. Flex, welcome to the box.
Hi, how's it going, everybody? Nice to meet you, guys.
We're doing well. Thank you very much for the impromptu feature. This is good. This is cool. You even put
like
on.
We look like the Step Brothers. Can I just say that for a minute? Like, God, we're ready for Christmas pictures.
Are we best friends? Yup.
I think we're crawling in the garage. Let's go.
Signed by Randy Jackson. How many times do you think they just did outtakes? They're like, what is the best thing that we could say?
All I wish is they would have did a Step Brothers like they did Anchorman, where they would have had a full hour and a half movie of just shit we never heard of. That would have been rad because I've watched Anchorman and I was like, Step Brothers.
They're all good. They're all good. That early mid-2000s Will Ferrell is one of the heights of my movie viewing.
Oh, man. Yeah, yeah. From the Night at the Roxbury? Night at the Roxbury, then shortly thereafter, he did the what was that? The singer, I believe it was? That chick who, when I get excited, I put my hands on her armpits like this.
And oh, Superstar!
Yeah, Superstar, that one.
Superstar.
Remember that girl? She's like,
Superstar. That's good. All right, Flex, wait. You're not Will Ferrell. I'm Chris. I just know. Okay. And we should probably get to know who you are. And then we can learn all about Will Ferrell and good impressions. So
let's go, buddy.
So you are Mr. Flex. And where are you from?
Born in Seattle.
Seattle. The needle.
Needle, baby.
A needle.
Yeah.
Is Seattle a place where people are particularly proud to be from? Like, people from Philly are always like, I'm from Philly.
Yeah. I mean, I'm proud to be from Seattle because we love everybody. I mean, everybody thinks about Seattle like, oh, hey, come and have some coffee. Well, we can do that too. Yes. Some coffee.
Coffee.
No, I love the mountains. You know, for those of you in California and Oregon or whatever, on I-5 goes from Canada all the way to Mexico. And the stretch in Washington from Seattle to Canada, some of the most beautiful sights you'll ever see in your life when you're driving. Mountains, White Caps, Mount Rainier, Mount St. Helens. I mean, you see everything. It's gorgeous. I love it. I love my state.
Nice. So you're born and raised then?
Yep.
Nice. Okay. And then do you talk about your real name or are you just Flex?
Yeah, my name is Eric. Everybody knows that.
Okay, you're Eric. Eric from Seattle.
Eric with a K, everybody. Don't be getting it twisted now. Eric with a K.
Don't curve him.
Don't curve me.
Don't curve him. And your username, though, is interesting because I saw in your bio, talk to me about that. What is Mr. Flex? Why Mr. Flex?
Well, if for those of you that know me, a lot of people know me. I was in here in the beginning, and I was hugely into comedy, and it was before there was a lot of censoring on this app. I would stream with my shirt off. I was high into the gym, and I would always flex for people, and just people gave me the nickname of Flex, and I had some injuries that happened and I had to step away from doing that. And I thought to myself, people always thought of me as this Flex character because of my persona that I had, but what else goes with that? And I thought of who I am as a human being, that I've been through so much and I've done so much with so little for so long that I could do anything with nothing, that I thought, well, I could take Flex and I could turn it into a metaphor of when you bend something, it bends, but it won't break. That's called flexing. So that's what we do in life. When troubles or hard times or anything come at us, we bend and we don't break. Bend and reflect. So that's my motto. So I actually made a sweater. It's funny, and I want to go to playlist and wear it. And on the back, it says the best four-letter F word. and on the front it just says flex, bend, don't break.
That's good merch. I like that.
Yeah.
That's good merch. That's funny. Oh, you're very creative.
Yeah, very creative. If you don't mind.
No, please, please.
There's the back, the best four-letter F word, right?
I just wanted to keep it simple. And then there's the king, baby.
I like that. That's real simple. Bend, don't break. I like that. That's cool. I feel like you could really run that into like its own brand.
That's what I want to do, dude. I love this app. Like we were talking about Turk earlier. I've known Turk since before he was who he is now.
Okay. What is that experience then? I mean, you said you've been here since the beginning. So how did you originally download it? Why did you download it?
Well, I mean, typically 90% of us, you know, we're not looking for a video app, right? Like TikTok or anything like that. We're looking for something. I've been single for 5 years. I'm a single dad. I've dated two people since high school. I came to meet me to, you know, find a lady. And then all of a sudden I seen that it had live things. And it's funny because I don't know if we can mention other streamers in here, but Russ, Beard God now, I'd found him. He was the first streamer I actually ever went into. And it was the day that he had just got his top badge. He had like 600,000 diamonds. And he was talking about health. And I was managing a GNC at the time. And I just said, hey, man, I manage a GNC. Can I get in your box? And I was in his box for literally the whole day, 6 hours. And he fell in love with me. Everybody fell in love with me. The next day, woke up. He hit me up and told me to come to his live, did it again. And then from that day forward, I was a box bandit. I would hop around and jump around for people's boxes. And I don't know if you remember Will from Lit Fam. He's an original, you know, top badge on here. He, you know, kept telling me, dude, go live. We're going to support you. Go live. So I ended up going live and, you know, bless Meet Me and everybody who supported me and who still does. I made 1.2 million diamonds in 4 weeks.
Back when?
Yeah. Back way when, dude, when the app first came out. I'm talking about when Holly before. Okay, so guys, another thing, with Holly and like Kodak and all those people back in the day, they had a run to 10 million diamonds. Whoever got the 10 million first got their own emoji or their own gift. I'm sorry. So it was a huge run for that. Like everybody was trying to go. Like when Holly's gift came out, you would go into the gifts and you'd gift it. And it was her going like this. She was like throwing confetti out. Boom, yeah. Like this.
Yeah.
You know, so that was the huge run. And I was so blessed to have that happen to me. And you know, I had stuff happen and I had my badge for a short period of time. And now I'm here to get it back.
Okay. What was your content originally? You said that it was at first not smiled upon by today's standards. Then what did it evolve into?
Well, I mean, it just turned into, because people always come to me. It's kind of like they do Turk. Like when Meet Me was crashing the other, you know, last month with the glitching. Turk was getting blown up and I was getting blown up. Turk called me. I was like, yeah, dude, I know what's happening. He goes, okay, we'll tell everybody, go around and tell people. So that's what we spent our time doing, was calming people down and saying, look, don't freak out. And then of course we're going to have some fun. So me and Turk went out and had fun. We're not dumb. We're not going to cash out. That's stupid. But, you know, I go to him for everything. I talk to him for everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like he's a cool ass dude.
What is the platform? You said you love the platform. I'm interested to know why you love the platform.
Reaching people. Like people say, like, I don't care about diamonds. I have almost 5 million. I've regifted them all. The only time I've ever cashed out is from tournaments that I've won. Right. Mm-hmm. And I invested into my stream, like my gaming share and this and that and this and the other. Right. Everything else I regift. I want to be able to get a badge so I could sit there and talk to people who need to be talked to. Because I just sent you a message and you'll read it and you'll tear up, because I've done motivational speaking. I have my associates in criminal justice. I've went to many seminars. I've been in sales my whole life. There's so many things I've done to harness this power that we call a brain. I've had people come to me at the time of their trying moments, and there's nothing better than Indian stream and having somebody send you a message stating that you helped them save their life because they were on the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I love. I love, and I've cried on my stream. I've laughed and I can joke and I can have humor, but people know me. The real flex is that human being who can lift you up when you're down, but I can laugh and I could joke because nobody needs to walk around in this life being pissed off all the time and being serious. Life is too serious as it is. There's so much pressure when us human beings walk out these doors that we're in right now. There's so much pressure. When we're on this app, there's no pressure at all. Sometimes there is, but then it's false pressure. And that brings me to this. And sorry, Chris, to take over the show segment here, but I just want to say this, guys. There are a lot of people out here, and I've touched it, and you guys have all seen it. Chris, you've seen it yourself. people have social anxiety. They turn to this app for closure or friendship or to vent or to get something that they can't get from real life because they've tried. And that's what I love. I love being able to touch that human being who needs help and who is walking on that wondrous path. And we've all seen them. Every streamer in here has seen it. That one person or those two people who've caught you and who have stayed there and developed that bond with you and have stayed there countless hours through streams and have been there and changed their name for you and watched video ads because they can't afford to gift you and have done that because they want to do it for you. And that's what I do this for. Mm. I will sit in front of my stream for 6 hours if I have to with 10 views. If I have one human being in there who I am touching, that's all I need. Mm. That's power.
Do you have a particular memory or instance that really impacted you? It sounds like you've really invested. You've had people really, I'm going to use or commit, I guess, to the things that you're talking about. Has there been a particular time that you remember?
What do you mean?
As like, like a best of or a particularly impactful experience of with someone, a situation.
Here?
You were a part of. Yeah, maybe a conversation or a situation.
There's plenty of times, man. There's lots of times that touch my heartstrings. I get emotional when I talk about some things.
Mm-hmm.
I'm huge into the military because of my background, and I'm not going to say any names, but about a year and a half ago, I met this gentleman, and he sent me a message, and I instantly told him to come to my life because he was going to kill himself, and I saved him.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the biggest moment for me is, yeah, I can laugh and I can joke and I can have fun. But in all reality, when somebody needs your help, you got to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And I was there. And that made me feel really good.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel that as a streamer, there can be a disproportional or an unfair responsibility placed on you? Or do you feel that it just comes with the gig?
I mean, it's a double-edged sword, Chris. I mean, you know, it comes with the gig, and it's kind of like we're there to be there. I mean, it's a 50% chance no matter what we do that, you know, what an outcome will be, whether it's a question or this or that or the other. So that's where I've placed most of those questions at is on that. Is it's a 50-50.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a tricky line to walk. Like you said, it's a double-edged sword.
It is, yeah. Because, like, you could have a gifter or somebody who's like this. Like, I tell everybody, hey, if you have problems and you don't like somebody and I like them, whatever your guys' beef is, hey, and you don't want me to talk about, that's totally fine. But don't bring that into mine. And some people won't like that. Like, some people want you to choose sides. And it's like, why? Why should we have to do that? Why should we have to choose sides, right, when we should just be neutral? Like, can I just be neutral in my own life and not care about what you're trying to bring to me? Can we just be happy? Namaste.
Mm-hmm. As someone who's existed on the app
for Bob, a long guy, time. I love you, dear.
As someone who's existed on the app for a long time, I think that you and I both can agree that I'll use drama for lack of a better term. Drama can be a downfall of a person. What is your perspective or way to persevere and handle and stay neutral and to keep trucking through alive, to own it, control it, and conduct your life?
Perfect. There's a couple of things we'll hit on. We'll hit on a couple of things there. There's the negativity that you get, the harassment that you get, especially from a woman, and obviously belittling and stuff like that. If you have special needs or anything like that, I'll bring back before you were on the app, Chris. There was a girl, and she's still on here, and I won't say her name, but she was getting picked on, and somebody came to my live, and this was probably the second day after I got my badge. And somebody was saying, "Hey, this person's crying in their live. Somebody was in there harassing her. Blah blah blah." I went into her live with my second account, seen what was happening. I literally did an all call. I got Turk, Kodak, Holly, everybody on every top badge that was available on the app at that moment to come into this girl's live and gift her. Within 30 minutes, it was probably the biggest display of diamonds without a glitch in the longest time ever. She got like 600,000 diamonds in less than an hour. And I got into her box at the end and I looked at her and I said, "You see all these people, dear? All these people, when somebody comes into your live and they want to disrespect you and treat you disrespectfully, you have to close your eyes and put blinders on and remember that these people love you." Mm-hmm. Because just because there's one bad person doesn't mean that there's 10 other good people out there.
Mm-hmm.
So I tell people that all the time, especially girls. You know, there's a lot of girls out there who they're awesome. You know, they want to be able to stream and have appropriate content, but they're afraid to. I remember one of these girls that I'm building right now. She's amazing. She came to my live and she was so stunned. She was like, I just seen my first penis. And I'm like, I warned you. And it's horrible that we have an app in a structure to where, you know, a huge portion of those people are a negative aspect of it. And that's horrible. And then it deters some of the kind people who want to stream from streaming.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And then the third thing, Chris, is when people do come in and they do negative and they come in with negativity, I just look at them straight up. I mean, I've been through so much in my life. I look at them and I go, hey guys, this is an app and we have to remember that we're going to be here. If you choose to be here, you're going to be here. If you're not going to be here, then get off. But what's it going to matter a year from now? I have a mentality, Chris. I want you to look it up. I'm going to email it to you. It's from Brian and Tim Kite. It's called Focus Factor. It's an event plus a response equals an outcome. So an event is anything in life. Okay. It could be, let's use traffic, for example. An event is a traffic jam or somebody cutting you off, right? If somebody cuts you off, what's your response, Chris? Are you just going to let them by? Or are you going to sit there and cuss at them? If you cuss at them, what's the outcome? The outcome is going to be you're going to be fired up. You're going to get irritated and agitated, right? You're not going to be able to focus. There goes your day, right? Or if you want the correct outcome, your response of that guy cutting off, just be like, hey, he's got stuff he's got to do. I'm going to go on about my day. But that's about how everything happens to you in life, Chris. It doesn't matter what it is. If somebody yells at you or curses at you or says something bad to you, you stop and you think to yourself, how do I want to respond? Because that outcome that I'm going to seek is going to impact somebody one of two ways, in a good way or a bad way. And when people get that in our society nowadays, because we're so fast paced, we're so fast to react that we hurt and we offend people, that we need to stop and we need to think that maybe these people who are coming to us crying for help, they just need a proper response. So how we respond is going to give us that outcome.
Mm-hmm. Good insight. Now let's shift it to you then. Let's shift it back to you. You mentioned that you were a top badge and that for reasons that have not yet been discussed. Is that something that you would like to
discuss? Oh, yeah, I'll discuss it. I'll discuss it. Everybody knows. Everybody knows it to this day. And everybody fought for me to get it back, and I left for this reason. There was a top badge back in the day named Ari. And since it wasn't really screened content, she had her top badge. And she would wear like lingerie, and she's a bigger girl, but she was bending over in her live, touching the ground, shaking her butt. People were sending me screenshots and I could see everything. And I showed it on my live, the screenshot, and my feed ended and it said that I've been banned for showing nudity. And then I woke up the next morning and it said my top badge had been removed for breaking the rules of conduct.
Hmm.
And it said I had to wait a certain amount of time, blah, 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 in order to reinstate this and that and this and the other.
Hmm.
And then for a whole week, everybody tried. They messaged, you know, everybody that needed to be messaged. Turk tried. Willie tried. Everybody tried. Kat, Sonia, Tatum.
Well, I can't speak to it. I wasn't around. I don't know the situation.
No, it's fine.
As the case, you know, I'm sorry, and I hope that things can turn out positive. But the point of me asking the question was, is for you to have the top badge back, what does that do for you? Why is that important to you?
It's important to me to just, like I said before, just to sit there and give proper content. You know, I want to be able to schedule things out kind of like you do. You have your show. I want to be able to do things because I do voices. I do tons of voices. I want to be able to buy outfits and dress up like my voices and have that content for people. It's really hard when you act and you're a comedian to do the thing for 6 hours or to do this or do that. That's why I limit it to when people come in and I'll do my voices for them because I have tons that I can do.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to do that. And then I want to be that guy like Turk, you know, or like the other people, you know, that when you're sitting there and you're just streaming, that people come to you, they have a hard time. Hey, this is happening. That I'm not going to turn away from them, even in my stream. I'm going to sit there and I'm going to address it and direct it right there and live in front of everybody. So that way people can feel the real energy of what it looks like to help a real human. Because mm-hmm. when people see people helping people, Chris, what do they want to do? They want to go help somebody. They want to go do something positive, because the more positive things that we see in our life as humans, that's why I don't watch the news. We do more positive things. Surround yourself with positive people, positive figures, positive music, positive things, and you'll do positive everything.
Sure. Okay. If you were to have people take away from this conversation something about you, because you, I'll go on a limb to say you have opinions and you have insights. If you would like, in this, it's loaded, but if you'd like people to have a takeaway from this conversation with you, what would be the takeaway or insight, perspective, whatever you want to label it, you'd like for them to have?
I just want to say it like this, guys. This is an app that we're on here. Hey, Summer. Hey, how's it going, dear? Be you. And don't change, especially if you're going to be on this app for a while. I have seen people who even have their badges who have changed. And all I can say is just be you. Don't try to be somebody you're not. If you're going to be a character or somebody, you know, then tell people that. But don't try to lie about yourself, because a lie is a lie. and then be positive. Every day that you get on here, if you want to do something positive, then be positive. Because there's no way that you could do something positive if you feel negative or you're doing something negative. So, Chris, with all due respect, with that being said, if it's okay with you, you guys can favorite me. If you're ever down and you need somebody to pick you up, message me. I have Meet Me Plus, so your messages won't get drowned. I will be able to get to your top, and I will be there for you if you need me to pick you up.
For sure. Yeah. I mean, yeah. When do you go live, by the way? If people are interested in talking with
you. All the time, man. All the time. Usually big time in the mornings, you know, on West Coast time, and then, like, right now, this time.
Cool. All right. Anything last things you'd like to share or talk about before you go, insights, anything else?
Nothing. I just remember you from I've been back for 2 months, and, you know, I've had you favorited for a long time, since before you even had your badge, because 7 months, so what, you've been on here for a year. I know you 2 months into your spree on here. Mm. So, I mean, I appreciate you, and you keep doing what you're doing, buddy. You got the best face on the staff besides me. I mean, let's be real here. No, I'm just kidding. But hey, with all due respect, everybody, make sure that you continue to show this guy love, continue to support him. If you go to playlist, make sure you go up and give this guy a big ass hug. Make sure that you have deodorant on and some good ass perfume too, because we don't want my man here stinking. Other than that, everybody have a beautiful evening, and stay beautiful.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Hey. Thank you, Flex.
Don't forget to call the superhero if you need one. I'll see you later.
Yes. Ah. All right. Excellent.
I'll see you later,
Flex,
buddy.
Everyone. Thank you so much for coming on for the impromptu. That was unscheduled. We didn't know that was going to happen. In fact, we do have our last guest of the night here. Frosty, thank you very much for that. We do have our last guest. What's up, Peach? And to everyone else who's saying hello and sending gifts. Seriously, thank you guys so much. If you guys want, send a blast out. Let people know AP is here. If people came for AP. Yes, Flex, thank you so much for jumping in and talking. Please, I know a lot of people came here earlier for AP. We'll love to make sure that they can see this conversation, because AP, a lot of people were bummed. They were sad. So I'll give it a second before we have them jump in. That looks good enough. Okay, as far as the show goes, you kind of got the idea. Today has been a lot of conversations, different perspectives on how the app works. You know, you had Aaron, who had his musical style and his interests and the way that's helped him grow his voice and his confidence in performance. You have someone like Ben, who has ebbed and flowed and his interest and how he likes it. Then you have someone like Flex, who we did not plan, but has seen the app from many different angles and in many different ways. And that's valuable, because whether you agree or you disagree, everyone has a reason for believing what they believe. There's been a series of events and things that have happened in their lives that has contributed and gotten to that point. So on that note, everyone, I do not acknowledge the comments. I do not acknowledge the gifts while we have these conversations. I do genuinely appreciate it. And if this is your first time here and you've dropped a favorite and I didn't say thank you, that's why. I do appreciate it. Thank you for the roses, Gabby. To anyone else who's come by, all right? So I'll train focus. Cass, thank you so much for that, right? Okay, on that note, this is a conversation I've been looking forward to for a long time. I saw this gentleman talking, and we're just going to keep on the insight and perspective train, you guys, because here he is, ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, Mr. AP. Bam! I know what we're doing. All right, how's it going?
Thank you for the fire. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, appreciate you having me on the show. Like,
we have not had a chopstick interest like that. So I like that. I like that.
No, we didn't. What's up, everybody?
All right, AP.
Thank you so much for the gift, you guys.
We're going to run the show a little bit late tonight. So anyone who's
Yeah, sorry about that. Work kind of got caught me up.
That's all right. I've had a lot of things happen, and the fact that you still showed up and you're like, "Hey, I'm here. Let's do this, can we?" I'm really thankful for that.
So, get you guys.
Much love.
Thank you.
Let's just dive right into this. The way I met you was through seeing you on the leaderboards. I saw that you were wrecking things and doing an awesome job. Saw that you had become a top streamer, and I knew that you needed to be someone that I talked to.
yeah.
I went to your stream. first time, I lurked a bit, and I was really surprised about the content and things that you shared so openly, which I hope to get into. But just to start out with, can you please introduce who you are, where you're from?
I'm AP. My actual name is Kang, but I go by AP, Asian Persuasion. I'm from Seattle, Washington, born and raised out here.
Okay, see ya. We had someone else from Seattle just now.
Yeah, I heard that.
Lifelong resident of Seattle?
Yes, born and raised out here.
Excellent. What do you do in your free time out there? What's something that you like to occupy your time with?
So we have a lot of ski resorts out here during the skiing and snowboarding season, so that's always fun. Going on hikes out here because it's the Pacific Northwest. We have a lot of nice hikes, a lot of nice scenery out here. Other than that, I mean, you know, just typical stuff, gym, work.
Normally I'd kind of fluff the conversation, but you have enough hard-hitting material that I think it's just worth diving right into it. You have an interesting progress as a person. Can we take it back to high school? And who were you at that time in your life? You know, what was going on in your life?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that one more time? That jet was a little obnoxious.
I couldn't hear. I don't know what happened. Maybe it could happen again for you. I'm not sure. No. Okay. I think that the events in our life contribute to who we are as a person and help us understand the decisions that we make and get to the point that we're at. I think a lot of that can deal with who we were in high school and how we grew from that experience. So the question was for you, who were you in high school? What was life like for you?
So in high school, I went to a high school. It was Franklin High School in Seattle, in the south end of Seattle. And we were very known as a fashion school. So I kind of, when you were going into the high school, if you weren't really dressed very nicely, you weren't really considered one of the popular kids. Not that that was one of my intentions at all. But, you know, I always try to make sure that I was dressed nice. So as far as high school goes, I was considered a jock, but I didn't play any sports, any varsity sports other than cross country. But everyone knew me supposedly. So as far as high school goes, it was kind of like this, you know, like people were drawn to me. I had a big group of friends, and, you know, fast forward to today's time, you know, you kind of realize who your real friends are after kind of mature a little bit. But high school was pretty good. I mean, I was a very social guy back then, you know, never really closed off, nothing like that.
Mm-hmm. You said you read cross country, that made you a jock. You had a lot of friends. It sounds like you were a popular kid.
I guess. I mean, that wasn't really like my intention at all. But yeah, I was known around school.
I mean, does anyone intend to be popular, right?
No, I don't think so. I mean, unless you're a little overzealous narcissist, right? No, I'm kidding.
Well, welcome to live streaming potentially, right?
Facts.
Yeah. Okay. You leave high school. What comes next? Do you end up working, school, more school? What's next?
I went to college for a little bit, realized college wasn't really my thing. So I started doing just like some jobs on the side. You know, I got hired onto a window company for a while. After that company shut down, I kind of wanted to figure something out. So I went to a trade school. It's called Renton Tech out here. Renton's a city that's about 15, 20 minutes east or southeast of Seattle. But I went out there and got a machining certificate for CNC machining and stuff. But during that time, I had opened up a cleaning business, so I can kind of, you know, make some income on the side, keep bills paid, things like that while I was in school. Once I finished my two-year program, I had an opportunity to subcontract with the business I was doing, so to essentially open up my own UBI, you know, open my own business and get subcontracted. And that's how it started. And fast forward 5-6 years later, I'm still doing it.
That's impressive. How old were you when you opened up your own business?
So 7 years ago, that's about what, 22, 23 years old? I'd say roughly right about 22 years old.
So 22-year-old entrepreneur. Had you always had that mindset that you wanted to be your own boss and do your own thing?
Yeah, I've always kind of grown up, you know, like in the Asian culture, they're always like, be a doctor, you know, be a dentist, something like that. I always felt like I've always had a social type of personality. So when it came to like my first job, my first unofficial job was at a law firm as a desk clerk, as a document clerk, but my first actual job was at Sears doing vacuum sales. And ever since then, the natural knack that I had for like selling items and just kind of having a way with people, when I had conversations with them, I realized like talking to people and dealing with people is kind of like my thing. And that's when I kind of realized like that was the path I was going to go down, was kind of try to be open, positive, and try to, you know, positively affect as many people in the world as possible.
Absolutely. Absolutely. What are some things that people wouldn't guess about owning a cleaning business? I to be honest, I would not look at someone and assume they probably own their own cleaning company. But so what
cleaning business? Go ahead.
Yeah. Right. Well, what has come with that? I mean, I know nothing about the industry.
Yeah. Well, cleaning is kind of one of the easiest businesses you can honestly open up. It's all about contracts. You go in, you know, after businesses are closed, because I have a commercial cleaning business. There's construction cleaning businesses. There's commercial. There's, you know, ones that you do warehouses, big contracts, things like that. I just do just small little office spaces and things like that. With the business, though, it's really not that difficult. You file your taxes every 3 months. You know, instead of having taxes automatically taken out, you just file it every 3 months. I mean, the work is very, very easy. The way I came across this business was a friend of mine, their mom had been doing it on the side as like an hourly, you know, side income for, you know, the car notes and things like that. So I was, you know, interested in picking up something that I can do at night, still focus on homework, things like that in the morning. So when I picked that up, that's when I kind of learned about the business and realized how easy it was. And it's just a matter of going out there, getting contracts. You know, you don't have to worry about no quotas, no numbers that you have to hit, no goals. You just go in there, take care of the building, collect your paycheck every month, and that kind of just turned into my business.
I think you're undervaluing your hard work almost in a way. I wouldn't say what you do is easy, because you still have to have the hustle mentality, have the mindset to be able to find new business and close new business so that you can clean it. And that's
true.
That's hard work. That's hard work.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Definitely. And you're still doing it to this day. I mean, most small businesses don't last beyond their first 2 years. That's another feat for you.
Thank you so much, Claudia.
Concerning owning your own business and things like that, have things always been so positive for you?
No. Just about, I'd say, it was roughly about 2 years ago that I had lost about 60% of my income. Two of my biggest contracts that I had the whole time that I've had my business decided to go in-house, essentially go a cheaper route. Wow. So that was a big, big life shock for me, is adjusting to losing over 50% of your income that you had for 50, 60 years. That's kind of the reason why I fell across Meet Me. During the last, actually, essentially the whole time that I had my business, kind of going into what you walked into before with my stream, was I had a coke addiction with my ex. And during the time of me owning my business, we were kind of traveling a lot, you know, going out, living that little rock star lifestyle and just doing a lot of drugs and things like that. And our relationship kind of revolved around drugs at that point for so many years. And the reason I found Meet Me was, once we broke up, I was trying to make an attempt to become sober. So I had to separate myself from anyone and anybody and anything that was associated with coke back then. So initially during that time, I cut everybody off. Wow. So, you know, I was like, you know what, there's nothing else to do. Let me just kind of go on the app store. Randomly fell across Meet Me, got on Meet Me, joined a stream, or actually went live randomly for the first time, and had, I believe it was 3 or 4 people that came in, and those 3 or 4 people stayed for 3-4 hours. And realistically, they are the reason that kind of kept me going for streaming, because they're the one who educated me, kind of gave me a rundown about how everything works, what this whole live streaming thing is about. And because of them, I decided to take this seriously. And fast forward 6-7 months later, here I am.
Boom. That's a story that I feel like has a lot of valuable lessons to take from. So this person that you were with, how long ago was it that you met them?
We met when we were, I believe it was 18, 19 years old. So literally right out of high school. You know, we kind of talked a little bit. Then we decided to start dating when we were about 21, 22, like actually making it official. Okay. I met her randomly at a party. She was friends with a mutual friend of mine.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, now, Anastasia.
Prior to you two meeting and dating, was using something that was part of your lifestyle yet at that point, or was it more of an...
No.
No.
It was kind of... I never even touched coke. The only thing I ever did back then since I was 15 was smoke weed. And that was like my only go-to drug. You know, once in a while, you know, we'd want to try to venture out and do some psychedelics. When you're in high school, you don't want to try to experiment with things like that. So, you know, I experimented with like psychedelics, that but never those hard drugs until my ex and I, because when we had gotten back together, when we first started our addiction, I believe it was about 4 months that we had split for a little bit. Okay. When we got back together, like during those 4 months, she was off doing her thing. I was kind of off doing my thing. During that time, I had tried it for the first time. She had already done it for a little bit. So when we got back together, we were both already kind of exposed to it. So kind of one night was just like, hey, you want to go do something together? And then it never stopped for 5 years after that.
Yeah. What was the mindset? I don't think any person ever goes, yeah, this is something I'd like to do daily. You know, it's not all of a sudden end up wanting to.
What the fuck? Oh, a little mini dragon? Brian, shout out to Brian. Oh my god, thank you, Brian.
I'm catching some static. I can't.
A little interference. The audio is a little bit of interference in the audio. Sorry, guys. Thank you so much, Brian. I appreciate the dragon, bro. Thank you. So the mindset was, when we first started, it was kind of like an entertainment thing, you know, kind of something to do, just an activity to kind of enjoy ourselves and enjoy our time together. Once we started kind of going out and doing it with friends, it kind of became something new. It was something new to do with people. Once we stopped doing it with people, it was kind of like, it was just a comfort at that point. It was a habit, you know, we were just so used to picking up a bag, going to the bar, shooting pool, throwing darts, and just snorting coke. And it kind of developed into waking up with that hangover every day, being depressed, down and out, you know, the negative effects of coke and stuff like that. And having to deal with that every single day. And because of being down and out and feeling so depressed, you know, the only thing that would essentially in our mind make us feel happier was another bag. Mm-hmm. So that kind of just became our routine. Mm-hmm. And since I worked for myself, you know, there was really nothing that really tied me down. I didn't have to worry about getting up really early for a 9-to-5 job. I go to work whenever I want. I worked for myself. I didn't have to answer anybody. I didn't have to worry about how I looked to anybody at work because I worked for myself. So yeah. It was kind of like a recipe for disaster. The timing, the drugs that we decided to start doing, our type of relationship being so open with doing things together that it kind of just led into us splitting. So we essentially grew apart, which is completely fine. But I'm actually very blessed for us splitting because I honestly believe that if we would have stayed together, to this day, I'd probably still be doing it because it was just that difficult for us to do it together. Yeah. Thank you so much, Anastasia.
It sounds like the perfect storm, as you mentioned. You were your own boss. You had some disposable income, and you were with a person who was reinforcing it, as you were probably also reinforcing for them. But yeah, at that point, it becomes not just a habit. It's an addiction, as you mentioned. And addiction is a topic that we've tackled many times on here. But I, you know, applaud and appreciate you being so open and vulnerable about it. What would you say is a misconception that people have about people who are using a hard drug like that? Or for someone who has not been exposed and has never met someone, but has formed their own assumptions or beliefs, what would you say?
For me specifically, when I went cold turkey on it, I didn't have any withdrawals. I didn't have any cold sweats. You know, I didn't have any of those negative effects of withdrawals. So when it came time to me mentally making the decision to stop doing it, it was easy. So I was always under the misconception that addiction is not a choice. For me specifically, it was. So I was one of the rare cases that was able to make that decision for myself and to completely stop it instead of having to go out and find help for it. Some people legitimately are so mentally ill with addiction that they get caught up that they need help. Luckily, I was not one of those cases. It is a disease. The biggest misconception I feel like is the fact that people make the actual decision to be stuck in an addiction. You know, people make the decision to go pick up that bag every day, but it's not really so much a decision that they're making in their head that they're okay with, that they're going to be able to go to sleep and not lose sleep over, you know, that night for picking up that bag and feeling guilty and stuff. So that's the biggest misconception, is that people make the decision to do that. People end up doing things that end up leading to an addiction. Not to say that as an excuse, but it happens. I mean, addiction, like I was a firm believer that I will never do coke. You know, like I'm never going to touch that drug. Like the most I'll do is some psychedelics here and there, but I will never touch it. And I was that person that said that. And I ended up being stuck in it for 7 years myself.
Wow. 7 years seems like it'd be a very long time to put your body through that.
It was rough. Yeah.
Do you feel like your quality of life has improved since stopping, and if so, in what ways?
100%. During the time of my addiction, I always had this type of mentality of being on edge. You know, everything kind of triggered me easily. You know, I was easily irritable. A lot of things that people were doing, I felt really entitled. I felt like they were doing it personally to me. So mm-hmm. I kind of developed this mindset of always being negative, always being aggressive, always being angry, you know, and I kind of wrote myself off for being like that. So once I sobered up, the biggest thing I noticed was the clear-headedness, being able to think clearly, being reconnected to emotions, because that was the biggest thing about coke. You guys, is when you guys do coke for a long period of time, you guys lose your connection with your emotions. You're essentially emotionless. You just don't, just things don't really hit you like a normal person would. You kind of just numb yourself out over it. So yeah, exactly, numb, Cisco. So you become numb to everything. And that was the biggest, I think that was probably the biggest thing that I noticed when I stopped, was my connection to emotion again, being able to feel again, even just watching a simple movie that has an emotional part in it, you know, instead of being just numb and having it glaze right over me, actually feeling something, even if it's minuscule, feeling something about it.
Mm-hmm. I think it's very fortunate too that you were able to pull yourself and recover and be in a situation, because I think in 7 years, that's a lot of time for it to take the absolute worst turn. Yeah. So that is a very fortunate thing.
I have Meet Me to thank for that, honestly. So, you know, I really appreciate the app and everyone on the app and everybody. Even if I haven't met you guys, I appreciate anyone that supports the stream, because you guys as supporters, as friends and stuff like that, you guys definitely help me see a better light.
Mm-hmm. We'll talk about it a little bit. I mean, that's a valuable thing to say, that you feel like Meet Me helped you in your recovery and path to well-being. How do you mean that?
So I'm sure a lot of people on this app, even in life in general, can relate and say that, you know, there'll be nights where you come home from work and you're bored. You know, you don't want to be at home. You want to go do something, you know, like sitting at home watching TV, watching the same shows over and over again. It just seems boring. You know what I'm saying? You know, it's just the same old routine. So when I got out of my relationship, I was still doing coke by myself. I mentioned before, I had to cut everybody off that was associated with coke. So a lot of my friends over, you know, dating my ex for 8 years, a lot of my friends become mutual friends with my ex. So it was kind of hard and difficult, the idea of talking to anyone that knew us both. So I came onto a dating app just to kind of like kill some time, you know, and then I had no idea about live streaming. The only thing I was aware of was Twitch, where you know, you game and then you live stream your gaming and stuff like that. So when I found out about Meet Me, it kind of opened up a whole new world to me as far as social media goes. I didn't like FaceTiming people. I didn't even use emojis in text messaging. You know, now emojis is like second language for me on the app and stuff like that. And now I completely understand the whole culture of streaming and stuff. But Meet Me, you know, when I got on Meet Me, it gave me something to look forward to when I got home. So mm-hmm. I didn't feel the need to have to go out and go to the bar and do what I've been doing for 6-7 years. I had something new, something fresh, something exciting to look forward to, and that was just talking to my friends that I had met on the internet. And those four or five people developed into 20 people, which then developed into 50 people, and then 100. And then, you know, then I started regularly getting 100 people in my streams, every single stream. And a couple of my day ones are in here, like, what's her name? She was there from the very beginning. What's her name was one of the very first viewers. And she was there from the very beginning when I slowly grinded my way all the way up. And once it became, you know, like I said, like a consistent thing, that's when I finally went all in on it. Went and got a chair for myself because I was spending hours on stream. And if anyone is ever wondering why top badges all have these chairs, because we spend hours sitting in the chair, you guys. It just helps with our overall comfort, our overall energy. You know, we try to provide you guys the best that we can. And these chairs definitely help. Mm-hmm. But yeah, other than that, Meet Me is the reason that, like I said, you know, gave me something to look forward to, people to look forward to talk to, keep my head, you know, on my shoulders, you know, keep me grounded, basically remind me that, you know, there's more to life than just being stuck in an addiction.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, it's definitely a healthy alternative and way to channel yourself. Do you feel like as a result, you've not only benefited, but that you've been able to help or benefit others?
Yes. So when I first started streaming, that's kind of what kept me on the stream, was I was there to kind of express my struggles, what I was dealing with my split, my addiction. But as I started streaming more and more, I started having more and more people come in kind of talking to me about their stories, somewhat similar to mine's, if not similar, relatable to mine's, you know, or they feel like I'm relatable. So people started coming in and started talking to me about their addictions and kind of their struggles. And a few of the people were relapsing at the time. Wow. So the fact that I was like about a month and a half, 2 months sober, these guys were coming to me trying to get some advice and, you know, basically just hear some positive words. And I was just there to remind them, like, hey, you know, you made a mistake. You know, as long as you're conscious and you're aware of what you did and that you're coming to me about how you feel ashamed about what you did, that's a big first step into trying to become sober and kicking an addiction or a habit. Mm-hmm. So when I realized the effect that I was starting to have on people just talking about my story, that's when I realized there was something here. You know, there was like a purpose for me to be here. And the type of responses I was getting, that was the biggest part. You know, when I, like I told you, when I first started streaming, I didn't know about the whole streaming culture. So they started telling me about top badges and how I can touch more people would be able to see my streams, to come in and hear my story. And that's essentially what it developed from, was just the fact of the excitement of being able to positively affect as many people. And I essentially had a platform to do that. And when I realized that, that's when I knew like Meet Me was something that I need to pursue.
Yeah. Well, we have some people that haven't seen you or possibly heard that advice. And as you mentioned, it's a relatable factor. If someone does have a day where they screw up, maybe they relapse, they use again, they intend to not do that, I made the mistake. How do you advise them? What is your, insight that you can give them about it's not too late, or, you know, how do you move forward from that experience?
Well, the biggest factor in that is your mentality, whether or not you beat yourself up for making that mistake and going out there, or the fact that you're sitting there like, damn, I made a mistake, I need to do better. It's difficult because every situation is case by case. You know what I mean? It's really case by case. But when you relapse, the biggest thing is not feeling down and out about yourself, not feeling alone, not feeling like there's no one there to help you. You know, because when you go out and you reach out to people and you keep putting yourself in the same situation, you're going to end up pushing people away. It's kind of like that word being insane, you know, trying to do the same thing over and over and expect different results.
Right.
You know, if you continually put yourself in a situation and you're trying to ask people for help, give me one second. Get away from the wall. Get away from the wall. Sorry, my cat. if no one knows, you guys will learn. You guys will soon learn and meet my boy, Ubi. He's a little rascal. Yes, a lot of people are spamming his name in my chat right now. Uba, yeah, it's a Viking name. UBBA.
Okay.
So I think it's Uba. Yeah, okay, everyone knows me for yelling at Uba. Yeah. So, but what I was saying was just don't feel like you're alone. You know, don't feel like you failed yourself. You made a mistake. You know, the only thing I can really recommend is just don't be down on yourself about it. Just realize that the fact that you're sitting there thinking about how you messed up and you relapse, that you're taking those necessary steps to eventually sober up. Everybody's different. Everybody takes their own road, basically. There's a timeline for everybody. Each person has their own timeline. It's not a race to the finish. It's a marathon. It's as long as you finish and get to that finish line, that's what matters most. It doesn't matter when you get there, but as long as you get there. Yeah. So don't be pressured by... Get away from the wall now.
Can we see this cat?
Come here.
I like how the same voice of telling you the cat to come here is also the same way to get away. Like, get away from the wall. Also, now. Come here. I love this so much.
Okay.
Come here. I just got to know.
All right. He ran away.
That's fine. Okay. We'll learn next time. Okay, but needless to say that if someone is struggling or going through something, you're definitely an outlet who can relate and possibly.
Yes, definitely. If you guys ever need someone to talk to, you know, I spent 7 years in addiction and I tried to quit for 3 years. You know, I quit coke about 2,000 times. Okay, and after 1,000 times, you feel like you're never going to be able to stop. But trust me, there's always the grass is always green on the other side. It's just a matter of trying to figure out how to get over to that other side. That's really all it is, you guys. And whether that becomes whether that's people that you meet, a new hobby, you go travel and get your mind off of it, whatever it may be, you guys just need to be able to find that outlet. And if you guys ever need someone to talk to, make sure you guys favorite me and come check me out, because I'm definitely there for you guys.
Mm-hmm. So just to cover our bases and make sure, I would hate to have it be a situation where we've glamorized something. So can you please just give a touch on, you know, not even once, the fact of trying it is not trying, the results of it, you know, can you just touch that base for us?
Are you talking about the whole concept of like just trying to achieve something?
No. To start using, right? Like to just try it, or, you know, those things. Like I want to make sure we haven't glamorized the use of it because we've spent so much time talking about it and the sobriety.
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
Made a case to glamorize something that is self-destructive.
Yeah. Don't believe the hype, you guys. Don't believe the trend. It's literally a waste of money. like I said, I mean, to put it in perspective, you guys, I had money to blow. If you don't have money to blow, this is probably a drug that you wouldn't even be able to have an opportunity to get addicted to, honestly. You have to have money to be able to continually pick this up to even put yourself in an addiction. It's literally a short-lived high, you guys. I mean, the hangovers that you guys get afterwards, like, it may be fun. You know, movies and shows might glamorize it, like what Chris said, you know, showing, you know, actors, actresses snorting lines, doing bumps and stuff, and make it seem like that's it's a rock star lifestyle and stuff like that. I mean, it feels like it at the time, right? But that isn't that what drugs is all about? It's an upper and then a downer. You know, it's supposed to boost you up, make you feel like you're on top of the world. But what happens after that? It's always a yin yang. There's always a balance, right? If you're not naturally high off of life, and you're just off of some substance, you're gonna have a crazy crash and come back down from it. You gotta be able to find that natural high in life so that it can easily counterbalance each other. Because doing drugs is not natural, obviously, you guys. That's just gonna, you know, it's gonna mess you guys up. It's not good for your health. So don't believe the hype. You know, even though you guys see the show and stuff, you guys wanna try it, good for you. Just don't. It's just not worth it. It's not worth the hype at all. I spent 7 years on it, you guys, okay? Even if I, like, some people made a joke about it. If you go on vacation and stuff and you're out with friends and they have it, you wouldn't even do it then and there. I'm like, you know what? I spent so much time, specifically me individually, I spent so much time with it that the idea of it makes me want to throw up. Not even kidding. So, you know, after 7 years of doing it, guys, I thought I was living a rock star lifestyle. Nope. I look back on it. What do I have to show? Nothing. Okay? At all. Nothing.
But you've been able to help some people, and that's at least one thing that you don't have to beat yourself up for, and you can look back for. And also, thank you for that. You did an excellent job of putting that.
I hope so. I tried.
No. I mean, and like, that was not a rehearsed or canned response. Like, I genuinely believe that, because you would still be doing it and not have that mentality about it if it were something great. And so, yeah, again, that's.
I love you too, Gabby.
But you mentioned finding a personal high and something that you, to replace and, you know, not have that need. What has been that for you? Where have you found the
positive? Six. Sorry.
What has been the personal high that you've found to keep you going and motivated?
It'd probably be my friends that I have met when I first started doing this app. One of which, her name is Rachel in Color. She's a big time streamer. She's not a top bad, but she's always on trending. You guys see her all the time. She looks like a living Barbie. Rachel in Color, Spirit, which is also one of the OG top badges. Mm-hmm. Spirit. Those two were the kind of the ones that I talked to off the app, especially my two guy friends, Austin and AMS. And those were kind of the guys that I met from the very beginning. But they were the ones that I would talk to off the app. So it kind of started from when I first started doing the app. It was just kind of interacting with people on the screen, on the platform. Then I started realizing, like, hey, I actually kind of connect with some of these people. Then I started talking to them off the app. And that's when I realized what Meet Me was all about, the social streaming, you know, the live streaming aspect of it, was the potential to create bonds with people that you would never have an opportunity to meet across the world or even a state away from you. Mm. So that's really what kept me going, was having people that weren't a part of that lifestyle talk to me from the outside looking in. Mm-hmm. You know, not having someone that's within the coke addiction that's doing as well, trying to tell me, oh, we'll stop soon. You know, like, it's just, we just said what sounded good back in the day. But to be able to have people have an unbiased opinion, you know, where I can reach out to a stranger and talk to a complete stranger that has no type of knowledge about my history, where I don't feel like I can be judged by them. I felt like I could just have genuinely someone right there in front of me and just kind of tell me like it is. And that's essentially what kind of, you know, made me excited to meet as many people as I could on this app. Was those select four, you know, that I met from the very beginning. They left a good taste in my mouth when it came to Meet Me. So I was excited to come back every single day. Just what you needed, exactly, Brian.
I love that. All right, so just to kind of wrap things up, we spent a lot of time talking about your recovery, which I'm thankful for. I think you really helped a lot of people with that conversation. These days, though, what's the next step for you, or the next thing that you're looking for?
So Meet Me has kind of always been something like to build a social media presence for me. Like, this isn't my bread and butter. I'm not here to make an income, you know, like any kind of side cash. Like, I invest into my streaming or future plans. For an example, I have some clothing that I'm making. I will have a shirt for you, Chris, out at Playlist, obviously. and a couple of my other friends that I'm going to be meeting out there for the first time. But yes, I will be coming out with merch. The merch is already, the shirts are already printed and stuff. I'm just waiting for the right time to show it. But I already have that all going. So essentially clothing line, like a clothing line or podcasting, something like that. You know, I've always dreamed about being a YouTuber, or, that'd be so cool to be able to travel the world and be able to take videos and, advertise things and have trips paid for, or just live in that kind of lifestyle to be able to travel. So when I came on to Meet Me, I never had a social media presence. So I looked at this and I realized, like, hey, this is an opportunity to build some kind of presence online to potentially open up some doors that can lead into some future things where, like, I've dreamt about making YouTube videos, podcasts, and things like that. So as of right now, I'm just using this opportunity to kind of get my name out there and to meet as many people as I can. Because one of my sayings in life is to network. To raise your net worth, you have to network.
Good one. That's
one of the biggest things. So.
Excellent. Anything that we haven't had an opportunity to talk about tonight that you're passionate about, interested in, that you'd like to spend any time going over?
Not really. I mean, I live kind of like a pretty simple, I'm going to be 30. My birthday's on Monday, by the way, you guys, February 10th. I've kind of lived that whole lifestyle going out, doing stuff. I like to just be a homebody nowadays, like going out and being a little active, going to the gym, exercising, going rock climbing with some of my friends, like indoor rock climbing, stuff like that, which I haven't done in a few months, which I'm a little embarrassed about. But just doing simple activities to kind of keep your body going, keep your mental health going, your inner peace going, and kind of just basically trying to be in Zen, finding any opportunity that's any kind of therapeutical type of activity, something that gives me the sense of meditating. That's what I look forward to now. Because before I used to always, feel like I was missing out if I didn't go out and go party and stuff like that. Now I feel like I'm missing out if I miss the gym one day. You know what I'm saying? So it's just a matter of changing priorities and like what I find the most important. And that's definitely mental health and inner peace.
Awesome. Well, birthday live is when for you? Because your birthday's Monday.
I don't know, honestly. I don't know. I mean, I'm going to be 30. I've never been super excited about my birthdays, but, maybe Sunday night, maybe Monday. I'm not sure yet.
Okay.
Honestly, I haven't really thought that far ahead yet.
In general, when can people catch you live? If they'd like to catch you, guys, so make sure you hit them with a favorite. If you enjoyed this conversation, you enjoyed this content, make sure that you hit them with a favorite. Don't forget to do that. But when can people catch you if they would like to see more of you?
Well, I'm on every night, 9 o'clock West Coast time. So that's pretty late East Coast time. That's midnight East Coast time. I used to stream during the afternoon, 12 o'clock West Coast, but I haven't been doing that lately. I'm thinking about going back during the day, but for sure, guaranteed, I stream every single night at 9 o'clock Pacific, which is West Coast, 9 o'clock Pacific, anywhere between 9 to 10. And I'll stream from there all the way till 12, 1, 2 in the morning.
Oh, perfect. Guys, make sure that you light this gentleman up. He's already been set on fire by – oh, wait, no, there's some stack. Never mind. I don't know. Nothing happened. Nothing happened, right?
Nope, nothing. There was – no, didn't see anything.
Okay. Dude, it was so nice and so great having you on. Thank you so much for this conversation. Great, great content.
I really appreciate it. Thank you so much, Chris. Make sure you guys all favorite up Chris. Guys doing great things by doing the show on here. I mean, it's definitely given a platform for any new and up and coming streamers. Don't be shy, you guys. Make sure you guys reach out to him. He's a very friendly guy, very sociable, very open. So yeah, make sure you guys definitely get your names out there. Don't be shy, you guys. All right, appreciate the love, you guys. Everyone have a good night.
Much love, dude. Thank you so much. There you have it, guys. 4 interviews. We did an extended run. I knew we had to have that conversation, right? Well loved for a reason, and now if you haven't had the chance to meet him or talk to him, now you have. And make sure that you give him a favorite. Make sure that you give a favorite to all of the lovely people that we had on today, like Aaron Kirby, like Ben, like Flex, and like Mr. AP, right? So tonight was an excellent night. Not as much humor, not as many jokes. I shift, right? If the content's serious, we got to make sure that we respect it and pull out what's most valuable and what's the most valuable information. So thank you so much for everyone for being by tonight. If you would like to be on the show or you know someone who should be on the show, please message me on Instagram. My Instagram is the same as this right here. It's Chris Casper. And you can also message me on here. A little bit harder for me to see unless you have one of those Meet Me Plus accounts. Things get right. All right. Playlist is coming up. I hope to see you there. Send me a message if you're going to be there. But until then, everyone, had a great night. It's great seeing you. Thank you so much to the favorites. And one more time, so much, so many thank yous to Lexi, as well as to Clary and Cass. All of you guys, thank you so much for all your generosity. I mean, as well as Ari and Mark and Gabs and Nisa, right? And Lori and all the other people who are here. So much love, you guys. I will see you tomorrow for our normal goofy shenanigans.